This video is sponsored by EcoFlow. Imagine for a second that we could power the entire United States with solar energy 24/7, even when the sun wasn't shining, by harnessing solar energy from parts of the world where the sun was, all without using batteries or any form of energy storage. Now expand that idea to the entire world. Could this be possible? How? What would it take and how much would it cost? And if it were possible, would we actually want to do this? Yes, a worldwide solar network. This is what I call a thought experiment or a Gedanken experiment. It's one of my favorite things. I'm Ricky, and this is Tuba Da Vinci. One of the keys to carbon neutrality is electrifying everything. While that in and of itself is a major engineering challenge and not one we can currently solve in many sectors of the world economy, an equally important issue is covering all that electric power demand with clean, carbon-free electricity. This means renewable energy. And when it comes to renewables, solar is king. The Earth continuously receives 173,000 terawatts of power from the sun. On the flip side, the maximum power consumption by the entire world at the max point in any given day is only about 19 terawatts in 2021. Not that 19 terawatts is a small amount, but compared to 173,000? So there's enough solar energy then to cover the world's demand almost 10,000 times over, or 2,000 times when you consider the average solar panel has an efficiency of about 20%. In fact, we could cover the entire world's current electricity demand if we only covered 1% of Australia's surface with solar panels. So why don't we? Solar energy has a major problem, which is the fact that the sun doesn't always shine. I know, big shocker. A cloudy sky can reduce PV generation by anywhere between 20 and 90%. And since we can't predict the weather yet, this unpredictable intermittency makes running a stable grid next to impossible with solar panels alone. But the bigger problem is the fact that the sun doesn't shine at night, making it impossible to power a solar farm 24 hours a day. So the only way to make renewables work would be to store that excess energy, which historically has meant pumped hydro or lithium iron batteries. But pumped hydro can't be installed everywhere, only in places where there's hills and bodies of water, and lithium ion battery solutions and supply chains have limited how much of it we can make. So yes, solar panels don't work at night, but it's always noon somewhere. In other words, the sun is always shining down with its maximum power somewhere on the Earth's surface. This got me thinking, what if we could chase the sun by building a worldwide network of interconnected solar power plants that would provide power both locally and to the places where the sun isn't shining or wherever generation isn't able to meet demand? This would allow us to minimize the need for energy storage, since multiple power plants spread across vast distances will more likely be able to cover each grid's demand and compensate for any fluctuations in power generation. To understand how this idea would work, and before we tackle the whole planet, let's just look at the US. This map shows the part of the Earth's surface that is hit with sunlight when it's early morning on the East Coast. Now look at how when it gets dark in NYC, we still have 3 hours of daylight left in California. If we send solar power from California to New York City when it gets dark there, we could cover a full 3 hours of demand before it gets dark in California. New York City gets sunshine from 6 a.m. to 8 p.m. on a typical summer day, and from 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. in the winter. This means we'd need to store enough energy to run New York for about 10 hours to the night in the summer and 14 hours in the winter. How much energy is that? To answer that, let's look at the average daily demand for electricity in New York City during the winter, based on data from 2021. You can see in this chart that NYC has its lowest consumption at around 4 a.m. and its peak at 6 p.m. When we add up all the energy on this chart for 24 hours, we get 408,000 megawatt hours or 408 gigawatt hours of demand per winter day. If we add the demand from when the sun is shining, 8 a.m. to 6 p.m., we get 180 gigawatt hours. So the remaining 228 gigawatt hours consumed at night would be the amount of storage we'd need. But if we deliver power from California to NYC from 6 p.m. to 9 p.m., we could offset 57 gigawatt hours of those 228, reducing the need for storage by 25%. If we apply the same logic in summer, things get even better since there are fewer nighttime hours. In this case, California sun power can offset 35% of New York City's required energy storage. This is the EcoFlow Dual Fuel Smart Generator. Yes, I said fuel. You probably know I love EcoFlow. I have 2 Delta Pros, 2 Smart Extra batteries, and a smart home panel that powers the Tuba Da Vinci HQ. And with these temporary panels, I've produced over 800 kilowatt hours of energy in the past 6 months. But if the power were to ever go out and we had a few cloudy days in a row, well, that's where this dual fuel generator comes in. This is one of the smartest, most flexible, and efficient generators on the market because it ties in directly with your EcoFlow Delta 2, Max, Pro, or Power Kit systems. With about a gallon of gas, it runs for up to 3.5 hours and produces 5.4 kilowatts of energy. On a standard 20-pound propane tank like this one, it runs up to 12.5 hours and produces 20 kilowatts of energy. You can turn it on four different ways: electric start, auto start, started with the EcoFlow app, and manual start. But the killer feature is how it ties into your EcoFlow batteries. Set it to fire up when your batteries reach, let's say, 20%, and it'll keep them topped off day or night, rain or shine. Hope for the best and prepare for the worst. That's one of my mantras. And with the EcoFlow generator, I hope to never need it, but I have it if I ever do. This is EcoFlow's biggest sale season. And with huge savings on their smart generator and all their other amazing products, check out the awesome deals today, links in the description. Huge thanks to EcoFlow and you for supporting the show. So all we've explored so far covers three time zones in one country. Now, let's say we apply this same logic to the whole world. One solar network, running everything on sunshine from around the world. Each location would produce its own energy during the day and export the excess production to where it's still night out. In order for this to work, we'll need to build a network of solar farms that evenly covers all time zones. The key requirements for locations will be lots of sunshine throughout the year, lots of available uninhabitable land, preferably not farmland, and proximity to densely populated areas. The minimum number of solar farms for our hypothetical network would be 3. That way, at any given time, we either have maximum generation at noon on one farm or a combination of lower output in the early morning and evenings of 2 other power plants. Based on this map of potential solar power generation, we identified the following 3 sites for our ideal locations: the Mojave Desert in California, Central Australia, south of Darwin, and Algiers, northern Africa. These 3 locations are ideal since they provide just enough overlap between morning and evening daylight hours to generate an almost continuous amount of solar power no matter where the sun is shining, as you can see in this table. So here, Greenwich Mean Time is added as a fixed reference and cells highlighted in yellow show daylight times. Notice how whenever there's only one power plant receiving sunshine, it's around 1 p.m., which is when the sun is at its peak intensity. So what we saw proves that we can generate solar energy 24/7 by building just 3 solar farms. But each power plant has to be able to send energy to the entire world. This brings 2 challenges. Each power plant would have to be massive, and we'd need a way to send electricity thousands of miles away. But exactly how big do these plants have to be, and what would be needed to transmit electricity across such far distances? Well, let's first look at the main components of the system. For generation, we'd obviously need solar panels. When it comes to transmission over vast distances, we'd need high voltage direct current, or HVDC, transmission instead of your typical AC transmission. And there's several reasons for this we'll get back to in a bit. So how much generation would each site need? This is where things get interesting. In principle, we'd need every one of the 3 proposed solar plants to produce enough power to cover the world's demand. That means effectively generating 173 terawatt hours, how much we use as a planet per year between the 3 sites. According to Solar Global Atlas, a utility scale solar farm with a nameplate power capacity of 1000 kilowatts peak would yield approximately 2 gigawatt hours per year. That means that to produce 173,000 terawatt hours per year, we need an installed capacity of around 86.5 terawatts. So assuming we build these farms with the most powerful utility scale panels in the market, which are rated around 700 watts peak, we would need 123 billion panels. Yeah, that's a lot of panels. Each panel is 2.4 meters long by 1.3 meters wide. Considering the optimal tilt about 30 degrees in Australia, each panel would have the footprint of about 3 square meters. So the total footprint and size would be about 82 million acres. That's a little bigger than the state of Arizona, a truly astonishing figure. If this sounds familiar, it's because others have done this math and came up with similar conclusions. But the interesting part is that we can't just put this one mega farm in one location. If we did, we wouldn't solve the nighttime issue. So we need to split this up into 3 farms, at least to start. Each farm would be 27 million acres, or 207 miles by 207 miles. So is this even possible? Does the world produce enough solar panels for such a project? According to Statista, the world produced 178,000 megawatts of solar in 2020, the latest data I could find. Based on growth rates, let's assume we produced around 200,000 megawatts of solar in 2022. If all of those were 700 watt industrial panels, that's about 285 million panels, or not even 1%, roughly 0.23%. That means it would take 430 years to produce enough PV solar panels based on today's production numbers. So Right off the bat, our dream of a worldwide solar network isn't looking so hot. But there's no reason why our solar farm has to be entirely PV photovoltaic panels. Let's look at the Noor mirror-based thermal plant in Morocco, which produces 580 megawatts of solar energy, or the equivalent of roughly 829,000 panels. So yes, it would take 123 billion solar panels, or, put another way, 148,276 of these solar thermal systems like the one at the Noor Complex Solar Power Plant in Morocco. And yeah, that equally sounds really complicated and really expensive. If we could get the installed price down to $1.50 per watt, our three farms would cost about $130 trillion. For context, the world GDP in 2021 was around 96 trillion, the entire world. So producing enough panels or solar thermal power plants to power all of this is beyond challenging, to say the least. But that's not the half of it. What about transmission? So when it comes to transmission, we have to consider several factors. First, transmission lines. This map shows an approximate routing for our interconnection for all three power plants. The red dots are the three power plants, and the blue dots represent interlinks or major local grids or substations. The first leg of power lines that go from Australia up through Asia's most densely populated areas, through Russia, Alaska, and down America's west coast, connect to the Mojave Desert Power Station, and keeps going south all the way to Rio de Janeiro in Brazil for a length of about 32,000 kilometers or 19,800 miles. A second 14,000 kilometer line would connect these solar farms in Algiers to Europe through Spain and then traverse the Middle East until it connects to the first line in Beijing. This will help optimize energy transmission to most of the heavily populated parts of Europe and Asia. So, in total, about 46,000 kilometers of DC transmission lines stretched across the entire world and connected to existing local grids for local distribution. And if you're thinking, why would we use DC instead of AC like the lower voltage lines running to your home right now, let's talk about power distribution. The total power in watts is equal to the voltage times the current. The first thing we need to do is increase the voltage as much as possible because higher current means more heat, and any heat that's created is power lost. This is equal to I squared R. So if we doubled the voltage, we could reduce the current by a factor of 2 and the power losses by a factor of 4. This is why high voltage and high voltage DC is so important. High voltage AC has some drawbacks, like higher transmission losses due to effects like skin effect, where the magnetic fields created by the AC current forces most of the electrons to flow at the edges of the wire and not so much in the middle. High voltage AC is common today because the hardware to upconvert high voltage AC is much cheaper than high voltage DC. So for most shorter runs, AC is cost advantageous. But once distances stretch beyond thousands of kilometers, DC is the clear winner. In 2019, the Chinese completed the world's longest HVDC transmission system that runs on 1100 kilovolts. Over a distance of 3,300 kilometers, or 2,100 miles, with a power capacity of 12 gigawatts. So not nearly the size of our system, but this is a really good real-world data point. So 1,100 kilovolts times 12,000 amps gets you to the 12 gigawatts. How big a wire do we need to carry 12,000 amps and over thousands of kilometers? First, we need to pick our material. We need something with high conductivity and low resistance. Here's a list of the best conducting metals we can choose from. Copper and aluminum are the best choices here on price, but there's 81,000 parts per million of aluminum in the Earth's crust compared to just 100 for copper. So to best utilize resources, we'll be using aluminum for the wiring. Plus, since resistivity decreases as the wire cross-section increases, aluminum will definitely work because, as you can imagine, we're gonna need some pretty thick wire. More on that in just a little bit. Here's a table with all the calculations, starting with the Chinese HVDC system running at 1100 kilovolts. If we scaled up the numbers from the Chinese system, our cost just for aluminum rises from $2 billion to $31 billion. But it still wouldn't work because the losses, as you can see here, would be so high that you'd have no power on the other side. Your voltage drop would pretty much go to zero. So what if we use 10 times thicker wire? Well, now prices rise to $306 billion just in aluminum, and the losses are still too high. The only way we can make this work would be to find a way to get the voltages from around 1100 kilovolts to 1100 megavolts, or 1,000 times higher. If we did that, then with a 15.7 inch diameter wire, about that big, we could actually make this work. but that would require 62 million metric tons of aluminum and cost $153 billion just in raw aluminum. Forget processing or production or anything else. The hardware to upconvert DC power to such high voltages has just never been done before, and you can bet costs will easily rise into the billions. This is harder to pin down, but you can easily factor another $1 trillion in stations, substations, DC-DC voltage upconverters, and all the insanely hard and complex systems required to make such a system work. Then there is the labor of running 46,000 kilometers of ultra-high DC power lines through various countries and continents around the world. This again is hard to pin down, but a safe estimate for the total cost of transmission infrastructure is $10 to $20 trillion. So between panels and transmission lines, we're talking north of $150 trillion, higher than the entire world's GDP. Beyond cost, there are many other challenges to overcome before installing a crazy system like this. Permits would be a nightmare, since we would need thousands of acres of land on very specific routes just for the massive power lines, plus the huge area for all the solar panels. Geopolitical instability would also be a major issue. We already saw how the war in Ukraine affected the worldwide energy supply and is threatening Europe as winter gets colder. On the other hand, even if we did manage to round up all the political will in all the countries, governments change, and the next one may not be willing to carry on with the construction of a stretch of power lines and substations, potentially jeopardizing the entire project before completion. Then we have terrorist attacks. Imagine if we turned on the system and all the world was running on solar from Algiers and a group of terrorists bombed that power plant, leaving the world in a blackout. As it is, the system is too centralized and too easy to target for anyone who wants to wreak havoc. So even though our worldwide solar network is pretty decentralized, it is still really interconnected and interwoven and easy to disrupt. Weather would also be a major issue. Even though the chosen locations don't get many cloudy days in the year, they might. One time or another. Solving this would require building additional plants far away from each other so that local climatic conditions don't threaten or cause a major outage. So as we're winding down this thought experiment, what have we learned? Well, first of all, to build something like this probably just isn't possible today. We don't make enough solar panels. The cost would exceed the entire world's GDP. So a lot of planning would have to go into this. But the reason why I made this video is because I've been deeply curious about this. What if we actually did pull this off? The cool thing is we could scale this up. We don't have to run such massive transmission lines to start. First, make the network, right? And identify locations that want to build plants. And maybe in the future, other countries go, hey, this is a financial opportunity for our country that has lots of desert land, like the Sahara, for example. We want to participate and sell our energy to the Americans and the Europeans and the Asians, right? So if there's a value, if there's a business use case, this could be interesting. I think of this as kind of the analogy of roads and railroads. When we built roads that stretch from the entire US or the Pan-American Highway that goes from the US all the way down to South America, that allowed people to do commerce much more widely. So a furniture maker in New Hampshire could make a chair and sell it to a customer in San Diego. That infrastructure investment does open up new opportunities. And if the entire world were on a smart grid, the next thing we would need is kind of a microgrid and smart calculations and projections, kind of like a auto bidder online marketplace. If we built that out, you could be incredibly financially incentivized to have these plants because you could produce tons of power at really peak demands for a ton of energy. It doesn't really matter at high noon in the Sahara if the demand spikes in New York, for example, at 8 p.m., right? That energy could be sold to anybody around the world. So it is possible if we use aluminum, if we invent new DC high voltage transmission technology, but how cool would that be, right? I just, one of those things I wanted to run out. So hopefully there's some stuff there that you guys kind of learned. I've been curious about this. I kind of wanted to know what it would take. Turns out it would take a lot. It's pretty tough to pull off. All right. So if you have any questions or comments or other things like this you want us to cover, write us in the comments below. You know we read all your comments and stuff. We love making these videos. And until next week, check out this video next. We think you're going to like. I'm Ricky. This is Too Bit Da Vinci.